We would like to present some of our results of the last year. So all these years we've been working with Globiome, and I think we've come up some interesting stuff when we tried to model the regional distribution of Russian crop production with Globiome to see how the greenhouse gas emissions do at different levels of our regions, how do they respond if there is some intensification processes or land expansion processes. So the reason why we were interested in this topic, so this first picture is kind of a historical background on the Russian development. So the blue bars is the crop production, which has been increasing in the last few years. And the green line is the respective greenhouse gas emissions from crop production and from land expansion. And for some years, for example, 2011, you would see that it's kind of jumping the additional burst of greenhouse gas. So according to Russian national GHG inventories, when you expand the cropland, even if it's a relatively small amount, you would get very high emissions because of the certain carbon content, because you turn the land once again. But the Russian national GHG inventories, they don't give the picture for particular regions of Russia. That's why we wanted to see what could be, let's say, the parts of Russia where this problem could be critical. So we just call it relatively simple to evaluate the carbon footprint from a crop production. We wanted to understand what regions are sensitive for cropland expansion. And for this, we had three objectives. So first of all, we wanted to put the official data of Rostat, Russian statistical agency, into Globiome. So for those crops which are in Globiome, the harvest area and the production area. And since Globiome consists of these squares called Luids, we want to correctly redistribute the Russian regional production into this, to the proper Luids. After that, we run the model, we look at what kind of emissions the crop production, the increase of crop production produces. It could be crop emissions, it could be land use change emissions. And after that, we create an additional variable. We divide the crop emissions to the production amounts. We call it the grain equivalent. And also another important issue is that we calibrated the data on the historical data for 2011 and 2017. So this grain equivalent, you can see it on this picture at the top. For example, it's kind of the coefficient which Russian Ministry of Agriculture created to turn every type of crop production into some equivalent where you can compare. So some it's closer to one, like wheat and barley, some are less than one, and high protein crops like sunflower, soy, rape, they have more than one coefficient. So we need this, since emissions are all calculated in CO2 equivalent, we needed this equivalent to properly calculate this carbon footprint. And when, for example, at the bottom of this page, you would see that when we tried to model this with Globiome, we managed to do it more or less correctly, all the production amounts and the harvest. And here we see that since there was actually some cropland expansion, you would have a lot of emissions from this cropland, particularly 46 million, as the model calculates. So this picture is a little bit technical because we did a lot of changes in the model, in the coding, to kind of to redistribute the Russian region production to the particular Luids. So if you ever worked with Globiome, it has certain variables for crop area, for crop data, which my colleague Vladimir worked on. Maybe it's also important to mention that Right now, Globiome covers, I think, 65% of Russian crop area. Most of the crops which we worked, it's wheat, corn, rice, rapeseed, barley, potato, sunflower, soya. For other crop types, it's kind of a little bit small. And also, Russia has this specific area of feedstuff, grass feedstuff for, it is considered a cropland, but in Globiome, it's kind of not. The cattle is on the pastures. And also some procedures were done to calculate the shadow price. Also, it helped us to redistribute this production amounts and harvest more or less close. So this picture, the next one, could be a little bit more interesting because here we have all these eight crops and the respective Russian regions. Russia is divided into 80 regions, something like this. And we just put them on this line to see how the model results closely match the official data. So for some crops, we actually had success, like sunflower and wheat. The model, for most of the region, the model managed to estimate more or less precise. But for some crops with very small fields, like potato and rapeseed, the model still gives some deviation. So by now we couldn't make it any more precise. So now how does this look into, let's say, terrestrial distribution? So on this picture, we have two pictures. At the bottom of the picture, it's kind of the crop production and this grain equivalent that we have. So it's most of the crop production is concentrated at the, what we call the southwest of Russia or the Black Sea Basin, closer to the sea, where the most favorable climate conditions, the best soils. And if we move a little bit northern, you would have less red red color because there is some production there, but not much, no, compared to this region. But at the top of this of the picture, you would see the emissions from the nitrogen use and from land use change emissions. You would see that there is much more red regions, which have emissions more than 3 or 4 million per one region, million tons of CO2. So we see that some regions which don't have as much production as in Black Sea, they still cause a lot of emissions. And that's why we wanted to see this carbon footprint. And so this was the main picture that we wanted to do. So here we have, so the average carbon footprint for Russia will be 0.5 CO2 equivalent if we compare it with 1 ton of grain equivalent. The blue regions on this picture is the ones with, let's say, more favorable conditions, and they give less carbon footprint. It's less than 0.5. It's a lot of regions in Siberia, in the Volga region, in the southwest of Russia. But all the ones with the red color and the black color, they cause large amounts. Well, particularly for Russia, it's large amounts of carbon footprints. It could be 2, 3, 4, 5 tons of CO2 equivalent per 1 ton of grain. And for some regions here, it is caused actually by cropland expansion. Like, for example, in the center, you see this, what we call Far Eastern District, because they had a dramatic decline of the cropland in the beginning of 2000, and they started plowing this land back. Although the national statistics doesn't report it, we think that it could cause large greenhouse gas emissions, and they were not compensated by large yields. So that's why we think it could have been a historical problem. And also another important thing, the last picture, is we wanted to compare our results with, let's say, some kind of soil sciences. And we found the paper of Dmitry Shipachenko. He works in EASA. So he did a paper with his colleagues about the carbon content in different parts of Russia. So on this picture, you would see, let's say, in the southwest of Russia, let's say the bright parts where the carbon content is relatively small in the soil. And then when you move to the north or to the farther eastern, it becomes more darker. So you would have the more carbon in this area. And we think it's kind of more fragile territories. And we think it's more or less close to what are results of the Globiome model. I don't know if Globiome uses Shepachenko maps or not. I couldn't find out that. Anyway, we think that our results could be close to this kind of other soil research. So that's what we needed. That's what we wanted to share. Thank you. Maybe questions.